got the organ today?
Good morning.
Good morning.
And in answer to your question, no, they do not have the organ fixed. The organ is sort of on life support. And so they will, I think Gail said, they figured out what most of the problems are. But so if you hear, if it starts to sound like Halloween or whatever, it's not Gail's fault. The organ still has kind of a mind of its own. And it, how old did you say it was, Gail?
He says at least 45.
It's at least 45 years old. So it's going through a midlife crisis.
I'm at least 90 and I'm still going. So,
but it is nice that they were able to at least get it so that Gail's able to use it a little
good.
Bit. It
sounds good.
It does sound good. Thank you, Gail. Okay, several things. The crop walk is already next Sunday. And Sam, do we know who from our church, if anybody's doing this? I know Ruth used to do it and other people, but they're not able to. Is anybody here doing the crop walk? Okay, if not, I bet if you ask around, there's probably some people in town we could...
I sent a few to Antrim.
Okay.
And there's two or three out in the narthex.
The sheets.
I'm guessing that if you want to make a contribution toward that, leave it in the office and say...
That we'll get it there. Okay. Well, it's actually supposed to be like 90 degrees next Sunday, so hopefully. Greatly. Now, the other thing is, somebody asked, we don't have an insert for the food bank, but do you know what they need, Sandy?
Kenny bought a lot this week, and that's all pretty well taken care of. We need anything but.
Anything but.
Green beans.
So basic canned vegetables,
right.
But not green beans.
Not green beans.
Okay, not spinach. No canned spinach.
No spinach, no beets, you know, ordinary things.
Growing up, I thought spinach was the worst thing God ever made. Then I figured out it actually tastes pretty good when it isn't slimy in a can. And when we were in Europe, where Ireland way back when, Pam hates it worse than I do. And guess what we had like 3 or 4 meals in a row? Canned spinach. And they were very insulted if you didn't eat what was on your plate, so I got to eat mine and hers. Thank God it wasn't liver. We are glad to see Pastor Nate back, and speaking with him briefly, on the plus side, he had a good trip, and on the even better side, he did not come back with an accent. So we feel good about that. Sandy, the office will be closed tomorrow, right? You're going to be for a rec commission trip. That's pretty far ahead. We still need, I haven't been by. Which is the parsonage lawn in pretty good shape, or does it need mowed now?
It was mowed. It mowed.
Okay, well, we should be okay then, because even though we've had a little bit of rain and it's warm, we've got a lot less sunlight, so we should be in pretty good shape. And right now, the selling of it's kind of on hold, so we need to keep it up. Mark your calendars for, it's a Monday, the November 16th? Does that sound right? We are going to be hosting the church conference, so it'll be ourselves, Antrim, and Stafford. Before we get to birthdays and such, are there any other announcements that we need to make? Anything coming up? It was a good day. Stafford won Friday night. Second, K-State probably got a lot of people's pacemakers going. They won. And for all you KU fans, they didn't lose. So, birthdays. Sorry, Gail. I just had it. Okay, the Olives aren't here, but if you see Tashira or Trexan, you know, happy birthday coming up next Sunday. Cleo has a birthday. Is that true, Cleo? I'm just curious, if you're willing to share, how old will you be? How old will you be, you know? I'm guessing 75. 89, excuse me, I've been around college students all week, and you know what kind of hygiene they have. Let's sing Happy Birthday to Cleo.
Happy birthday to you.
Today until 9 until 3 o'clock, if you are interested in the vintage aircraft, and I got it wrong last week, it's a B-25, not a B-29, I think, also.
A what?
They have a B-29, they have a B-25, which would be a Mitchell, they have a Mustang up at the Great Bend Airport. It's a $5 donation, and that will be going on until 3 o'clock.
Not a B-24.
No Liberators, Jim. Sorry. You ought to give Jan Peters a call and tell him next year you want one. Okay. If there are no other announcements, if you would all please stand as you're comfortable, and we will read the call to worship responsibly. Come, let us sing to the Lord. Let us make a joyful noise to the rock of our salvation. Let us come into God's presence with thanksgiving. Let us make a joyful noise with songs of praise. For the Lord is a great God and a great ruler above all gods, in whose hands are the depths of the earth and also the heights of the mountains. The sea belongs to God, who made it, and the dry land, because God formed it. O come, let us worship and bow down. Let us kneel before the Lord our Maker. If you would all please turn to hymn number 79, and we will sing, Holy God, we praise thy name.
Oh,
offering on that side. And Steve, could you help here? And Mark, would you help Joe in the middle? Amon. I figured you did. Thank you. Okay. This is Acts 26, 28, maybe. Agrippa said to Paul, "Are you so quickly persuading me to become a Christian? The word of God for the people of God."
Thanks be to God.
Well, good morning.
Good morning.
I hear some voices out here that might be affected by ragweed and other special things at this time of year, like screaming too loudly at football games night after night over the weekend. That's kind of where my voice is this morning. So, it's good to be back. It's good to be. It's good to know that you survived Kim Ellis's preaching, and evidently he didn't because he's gone this weekend. But it's good to see you all here. Had a wonderful experience at Mount Sequoia in Fayetteville, Arkansas. And I expected it to be up in the mountains apart from Fayetteville. See, I'm from California. The mountains are separated from cities. But this was like right there within the city, and it overlooked the city, and it was beautiful. But I have some new friends, and my roommate was actually Korean, and he's been in the United States for 11 years. And just hearing him tell stories, for example, he was in China and met a North Korean in China. And when the North Korean found out that he was a pastor, he began weeping and asking, "Would you please serve me communion? I haven't had any for 35 years. And that, to me, tells of not only how valuable our Lord's Supper is and how important it is for faith and for life of the Christian, but also how fortunate we are to be recipients of that as often as we do. So, but I have a number of new friends and colleagues, and it's been a wonderful experience. But glad to be back. I want to spend some time this morning in prayer. Marlene, would you like to share your situation tomorrow?
Well, I will be having a knee replacement in Pratt.
Okay. And what time is that?
Well, I have to be there at 6, so it'll be early.
So it'll be early. So please, as you wake in the morning, please pray for Marlene. Any other prayer requests this morning?
Sandy, do you have any details? I know Farrell Dean hurt her knee. Yeah. Is that correct? Anybody have details?
Yeah. I went to see her just before surgery and was able to pray with her. And she had a couple of children with her. And she had a fracture of the kneecap. And so they surgically repaired that. And she's supposed to be moving to a swing bed in Stafford on Monday. So I'm sure that she would appreciate our continued prayer for her as well.
Well, I have prayers for Janice Saylor. She's in serious condition, St. Francis Hospital.
I heard yesterday, too, that she will be brought back to Stafford Swing Bed.
Oh, my goodness.
She was one that had the brain bleed, right?
I talked to her daughter-in-law Friday, and it is no longer bleeding. And she has responded and talked to people.
But she had a bad set.
Oh, she did.
Friday night.
Oh, okay.
My wife's having surgery in the morning at Wichita for eye operation.
It's Tuesday.
Help me out with the first name again.
It's Marlene.
I come at your prayers. I'm flying into Upper New York tomorrow morning, not New York City, Upper New York, to visit my brother. I didn't want to coincide with the Pope.
Pastor, there just seems to be a lot of stressful situations in our community and the world. And I know we all have unspoken prayers on our hearts.
Yes. Thank you. But how about joy-wise? I did want to. Kim came in last week and really, you could tell he put a lot of time and effort in it. And he put together the whole service, right, Sandy?
Yes, he did.
And he also went to Antrim and did it, which is quite a, for those of you that might know, that's good that we were able to have that happen. And the other thing is there were 400 screaming, yelling kids out at Cheyenne Bottoms yesterday catching butterflies. So, they don't always have to play sports, and they don't always have to be in front of a computer. And from my standpoint, the best thing was we had a lot of Hispanic families there. And with everything going on in this country, vis-a-vis immigrants and stuff, it's probably pretty important that we all find a way to get along. And so that was very, very positive.
You looking for joys?
Yes, sir.
Yesterday morning, I had the most wonderful joys out at the back of my shop. Bobby Steinmates and his trucking bus met there to clean up a lot of that junk I had back there and make demonstrations out of it. But we may get rid of it. So one of your local members there, Hudson, was a part of that crew. And they got it all cleaned up, so when you drive down the alley, you see how clean it looks behind that building.
I drove
through
there.
I've got one thing left, and that's one of those 7-foot diameter reflectors. I've got another one inside, and I'm going to set up somewhere to make what they call a hiss whispering gallery. I saw this up in Chicago at the Building of Science and Industry. And the space is about 100 feet apart. You can stand in front of one of them at the focal point, and at the focal point is where you can hear what they say. That's something I can set up in the park somewhere, or it would be, I think, a really good demonstration.
The
alley looks clean.
After a pretty stressful week, we had the most wonderful evening. My dad, who lives next door, is 90 years old, and his wife came over to our little private place on our lot, and we had a wheat roast. And we sat outside and talked until dark, and it was wonderful. And I'm blessed to have my dad still
here. Amen. All right, let's go to the Lord in prayer, shall we? Heavenly Father, how grateful we are that you love us, that you approached us while we were still sinners, that you became flesh and dwelt among us, that you are the light in the darkness. that you are peace in the valley, that you are the new mercy every morning. Lord, for these and many blessings, we are grateful. Father, we thank you for this place of worship that we can join together. And Lord, we remember the words of Jesus in John chapter 17 as he prayed for our unity. He prayed for our unity. Lord, I pray that you would flood this people, this church, with the spirit of unity. Lord, our denomination also needs this very same spirit. Many issues coming up in the next year, and we just ask that the most important thing to you become the most important thing to us. And that is that we are one as you are also one. Lord, we give thanks for Kim and his giftedness. We thank you, Lord, that he was able to serve us this last Sunday. And we ask your blessing upon him. We thank you, Lord, for the opportunity that he had to also share with Antrim and the people there. And so we give you praise for that. Lord, we thank you that there is that sign of renewal in a relationship between the two churches. And Lord, we also pray for the unity of this people, this nation, with so many issues facing our day and so many people taking a polarized position, we ask that you would help us to unite as one people, as Americans. Help us to be compassionate, as is our heritage. Help us to be loving toward our neighbors, even if they disagree, even if they are from a different religion, religious background. Help us to be one. Father, we thank you for the testimony that people are helping people. And Jim shared that, and just we're grateful you have given this nation that kind of spirit, that we help each other out when we have needs. Thank you, Lord, for family and the value that comes from them as we can live and grow and hurt and have joyful times together. These two we give you thanks for. And Lord, we pray for each of the folks here who may be experiencing some kind of stressfulness in their life. Not the kind of triple overtime kind of stress, or single overtime kind of stress, as we saw in the football games, but the genuine stress of struggle in relationships and struggle over not knowing what the future holds in terms of health and well-being of our members here. We ask, Lord, that you would be the comforter that Jesus promised you would be. Lord, I pray for Janice and Marlene, Feraldine. Ask, Lord, that in each of their specific situations, that Lord, you would walk with them, that you would heal their bodies, but most of all, Lord, that they would know that you are there ministering to them, caring for them, that you have not forsaken them. too, Lord, we want to ask for safe travels for Anna and for all those people this weekend that are our friends and family who may be on the road. We ask, Lord, your blessing on them and protection. Lord, for all those that we have, friends in the military and friends that are in care homes in various places, we ask your comfort and care for them as well. And these and all things, as we continue to worship you, we commit them to you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Would you turn in your hymnals to number 354?
Love the Lord your God with all of your heart and with all your soul
and with all your strength, and with all your mind, and you, your neighbor, as yourself. And he said to him, you have given the right answer. Do this, and you will live. But wanting to justify himself, he asked Jesus, and who is my neighbor? The word of God for the people of God.
And then, of course, Jesus told the story of the Good Samaritan, the one who did not walk on the far side of the road around an injured individual who was traveling through and was robbed and beaten, the one who came to this person's aid and helped him, the one who was not of the same religious persuasion, the one who was not of the same nationality, that person crossed those boundaries and showed love. That's what it means to love. Well, as we go to the word of the Lord and to hear the preaching of the Lord, let's pray. Father, now may the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, my rock, my redeemer, in whom I trust. Amen. The key text for today's sermon is Acts 26:28. King Agrippa says, you almost persuade me to become a Christian. This is a sermon that a long time ago, John Wesley preached. And this happens to be one of my assignments from last week, so I thought I'd share this as well. Our instruction again was to write a 10-minute sermon out of an hour-long sermon. And in our own words, so this is my take on that. What is an almost Christian? In Acts chapter 26, Paul has just explained the gospel in the hearing of King Agrippa. He explained that he was born of a Roman citizen and raised a Pharisee, which is a Jew of certain religious sect and a high-ranking individual, who persecuted and killed Christians. He further testified how he met the resurrected Jesus on the road to Damascus, being changed from a persecutor of Christians to an apostle among the Christians, a teacher, an evangelist. In conclusion, Paul asked the king to testify that he also is a believer of the prophets. Do you believe the prophets? He said. I know you do. And in verse 28, Agrippa replies, you almost persuaded me to become a Christian. Another translation reads, a little more and your arguments would make me a Christian. Agrippa suggests that while he is not yet a follower of Christ, he has at least come to the point of agreeing that he is nearly a Christian. He has listened to Paul's testimony. However, it is absolutely critical that we recognize that an almost Christian is decidedly not one. Since the time of Christ, in every age, in every place on the globe where Christianity has sunk its roots, there have been many who were almost persuaded to become Christian, but before God, almost amounts to nothing. And this passage, King Agrippa's words, raises two important questions for us today. What is almost Christian? And secondly, what is altogether Christian? Our purpose here today is to look inwardly and examine ourselves to determine if we are true Christians or not. And then how might we respond to that determination? For some, becoming Christian doesn't take much more than a call to repent from their sins and believe in Jesus Christ. They have waited their whole lives to hear the good news that Jesus died to remove their sins. To save them. Convinced of their shortcomings, they have humble opinions of their behavior and their thought life. They unknowingly have already been convicted of the Holy Spirit. They recognize that they need a change, a new start. They know they need saving, although they are unaware such an opportunity exists. They simply need to hear the gospel message of God's love and mercy through Jesus. They are sold. They are faithful and obedient servants of Christ from day one. Others need years of persuasion. It takes them a long time to discover their need for a Savior, and longer still before they realize that simple belief isn't the only aspect of saving faith that is required for true salvation. It's not enough to believe. Even the demons believe and shudder, James the Apostle reminds us. They think that it's good enough to have one foot in the world and the other in the church. Those who believe like this spend their entire life making sure they look the part. Sure, they go to church, put something in the offering plate. They might even serve in a minimal capacity, they volunteer occasionally. But not for anything that might require a huge commitment. Just enough to look good. Around their non-Christian friends, they are unrecognizable as Christians. Jesus calls these people hypocrites, actors. Whitewashed tombs, even. They have a form of godliness, but deny its power. You have the outside of what you think is a Christian, but inwardly, however, you are proud and always insist on being Christian on your own terms. Some may be in this room today who have asked, you would say that you believe in Jesus, but then there's always that caveat, but I don't have to go to church every week to believe, or, but I'm not one of those radical Jesus freaks. Or, I could do without the candles, the hymnody, the liturgy. You qualify your identity as a Christian by what you are willing to do or not do. This is almost Christian. There is also no such thing as trying to become a Christian. You can't fake it till you make it. Either be a Christian or don't be a Christian. Almost Christian isn't any closer to being one than being anti-Christian. Years ago, one of my college roommates takes me to Wichita to a youth event. And there I meet this huge man. His name is Ernest. And he has a deep love for Christ, a deep singing voice, and a powerful bear hug. And so he not only shook my hand, but he hugged me. And our mutual friend introduces us. And the first thing that Ernest asks me is, Nathan, do you love the Lord? I'm caught off guard. I'd never been asked that question before. So I answer, yeah. I lied. I was playing a role. I was an actor, a hypocrite. Sure, I went to church. I put a dollar or two in the offering. I didn't cuss much. I didn't hang out with the obvious partiers. It took me a long time to sort out what that question, Nathan, do you love the Lord, really meant. I was almost Christian. I did not repent of sin. I didn't love the Lord. I avoided good works as much as I could, and only participated in weakness or in wickedness when no Christians were looking. A fine example of an almost Christian. An altogether Christian, on the other hand, first of all, doesn't do evil. This person has repented from sin, hates it, listens to the Holy Spirit's conviction, flees even sinful thoughts and attitudes and actions as though his or her life depends on it. First, doesn't do evil. Secondly, the altogether Christian is constantly looking for ways to do good. Serving in the church, visiting someone who is hurting, feeding the poor, encouraging someone who is having a bad day, explaining the good news about Jesus with someone who doesn't know him. An altogether Christian is looking for ways to do good. Thirdly, because of Christ's loving forgiveness, the altogether Christian cultivates a deeper relationship with God. This is the love spoken of in Luke chapter 10, verse 27. Love the Lord with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength, and love your neighbor as yourself. Any faith that fails to bring about the turning from sin, a rich love for Christ, and a walk that is characterized by good works and the avoidance of evil is no faith at all. It is half-baked deception. The altogether Christian is the opposite of these. God doesn't want your dollar or two in the offering plate. Keep it in your wallet. He wants your heart. Where your treasure is, your heart will be also. If you value Christ, he will have your heart. So what to do? Jesus loves you. Has God's Spirit shown you your sin? Are you like I was? A fake? A hypocrite? An almost Christian? If so, it's time to lay down your sin, to turn away from it, to repent. Lay your heavy burden down at the foot of the cross. Be set free from that life. There is no better time than today to receive God's forgiveness and begin a new life in this grace. Now is the time of God's favor. Now is the day of salvation. Your eternity hangs in the balance. As we prepare for the offering, I would invite you to pray the prayer that is in the offering, or in the bulletin, with me. Shall we pray? Mighty God, you faithfully uphold and guide us through times of difficulty and uncertainty. You show us steadfast love. Thank you for the kindness we have received through your church. Lead us to grow in gratitude so that we will gladly share our gifts. Bless these offerings to sustain our mission to those in need in our community. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Thank you.
back in one piece. We appreciate God guiding you safely. If you would all now please remain standing and turn to hymn number 389, Freely, Freely. Do this, and you will live. Amen.